Welcome to the 50th edition of the SWN Podcast. I am your host, as always, Billy, and I am joined in the special, very special edition with a man who is the only person, human, in the 200 Club on YouTube. He is Jason Hyde. Welcome
good
to the
morning
show.
Morning or after. That's how I start my one, but like, whatever time it is where you're watching, good that. Hello.
As we were saying before, this is almost Socialising with Jason Reed. Because I forgot your name for a moment.
If I could be Jason Reed, I would be.
So I think our last chat was some point in October, maybe, possibly.
I was going to say March, and I was like, wait, not as much.
It came out October 16th, so probably, knowing my schedule, July is when we spoke. But so, how's it going?
No, a whole lot's changed, actually. Just same as with the general world, but I've just been relaxing, really.
But you say that. You've seen how the experts do it and decided to set up your own podcast.
Oh, see, it's the good thing is I can happily admit it is far from expert. Absolutely missions away from expert. Like, the first episode of that with Krieger, I genuinely was like, have you got in prepared? And I was like, people prepare stuff. Like, that's no right. I can't be right because I've not done that at all. And then I just ran with the bad. Like, see, if I become self-aware of how bad that is, I can make that the gimmick, probably.
But so was there any particular reason why you decided to start it? Or, like I said, you see other people doing it thinking, this looks easy enough. I'll just
get going. They're just boredom. Like, I was literally just so bored. And I had a bunch of sound editing software on my laptop that I wasn't getting any use out of. So I was like, that'll work for a wee while. And then originally we keep always saying we're going to plan it. We were going to get me, Dean, Krieger and Matt Tyson, we're all going to do a group podcast. But then later on in the kind of process, I was just like, I'll just do one. And then we can put our original idea on as like a kind of subsection of my one. And then that never came to fruition. And then for there, I just kind of originally was going to do it with them again, but then it ended up being the episode won't be, I don't know if it'll be out when this comes out, but we done the TNA one. That was the original plan, but then somewhere along the way, I just decided, actually, I'm just going to talk pure guff to whoever wants to hear it.
So before anyone, just in case you didn't see the big explicit bit on the title, this will be a sweary episode because it's a celebration. So we can get some swear words out of the way. Fuck.
See, I don't like smoke or drink or that. So like, my addiction is just swearing. Everybody that you know, when I bring folk on my podcast, I'm like, listen, you can swear. That's how I'll get them on. Except for Emily Hayden, she's just not up for it, apparently.
Oh, she was the easiest one. I mean, easiest one on the podcast to not swear. Krieger fucked up like 2 hours in. So if anyone's listening to that, it's 2 hours and 2 minutes long, the podcast. He went 2 hours without swearing and then fucked up right at the end with one story. And I was like, I'm going to edit it. It's going in. I don't care.
I listened to that the other day, actually, and I was like, do you know what? He didn't put me over once. Not once. He mentioned me and said that I was overhyping the fact that he denied the existence of bats. You can't overhype the fact that somebody thinks bats are the real. He argued this fact with me. He was like, right, I'm going to tell you this in genuine confidence. So I'm talking about it in a podcast, so it wasn't the best of confidence, I suppose. But he was like, I just don't believe bats are real because a one flew by my house. And I was like, what? You don't just breeze by a conversation like that. Like, I know bats on the deal. Aye, the other no conspiracy, that's the birds. Birds on the deal.
I've enjoyed the podcast enough to tout it as my own content as well on the website. Is there any particular favourite guests you've had so far? Other than myself, obviously.
There was never a guest that I didn't like having on, to be fair. And if there was, I would happily just spill the shit on them and be like, either this one was a dick, that one was a dick. But they were actually, everybody was nice. I liked having Benny on because we are like, we just go together well in conversation. Like when we met, because we did obviously get put together as a tag team by Pro 2, but we had tagged before then. The day we met, I think it was like maybe 5 minutes after we had been talking, we were meeting, like, we were like just to each other, just walking by each other, going, I'm Rick James, bitch, like every single time we walked by. we've just got that wee kind of click, so that was quite good. And we like when I had Krieger and Dean and Matt on, that's always fun because it was literally like we're too lazy to type, so our group chat is all voice notes, so it was essentially just we let folk hear the group chat for a wee while, basically. So that was quite good. So I've never had a bad guest on particularly, and sometimes it's good as well. Like I had never actually spoke to Jetstream Jack properly before I had him on the podcast, and now like we got on proper well. He's very nice. Not that I was expecting to be a dick of that. I didn't have any bad expectations of him, but that kind of stuff's quite good as well. I like that.
Yeah, well, I mean, I enjoyed being on because, well, I mean, for you, Big Ben, it sounds like you it's like that stepbrothers thing.
Exactly.
Instantly, you'd be like, did we become best friends? And then,
aye.
Yeah. I mean, I had a great time. I didn't even feel like you were recording. I mean, I was even half sure you were. Because we were just speaking.
I did have that problem once. I can't remember who it was, but like, I spoke a good 5-10 minutes, and he was like, "Oh shit!" It was Brent Carter. I was like, "Mate, I'm no recording right now." And he was like, "I cannot stand you." Like, that was his first reaction to it. I was like, "Fair enough."
So you do have the distinction of being the only person, I said human. There's an asterisk there. Being in the 200 club, so that's why I had to invite you back for the 50th episode celebration spectacular. And if I remembered that, I would have had a party hat, but I've only got a chef's hat from the Bulgarian baker. So
I don't actually have any hats to my disposal. I found a wee jar, and I don't know what it's for, and it really intrigues me because like it looks like it contains some form of cream or like an aid to the skin. But it's empty, and I don't trust it. I don't know who put it there, and I don't know. Maybe the Illuminati's after me or something.
You haven't opened it or anything. It could be like a scream. Someone's like screamed into it and then tried to close it.
I don't know why that reminded me of this story, but there was this rumor that went about my school about this boy, and apparently his granddad like farted in a jar and then saved it for the next new year. And I was like, why would that happen?
There's always one story of a kid. I had a kid from school that when I went to school, obviously not a kid from school, like I'd randomly had one. But there was a kid from school whose big brother farted in a jar, and that was theirs. That's boys. We're a bit manky.
It's weird. That's like one of the things. Like, you know how like you see archaeologists looking at how like different cultures that had no relations used the same bricks when they were building things. How come different schemes have the same urban legends of people farting in jars? We're from very different schemes.
I'm in the sticks. I think sheep outnumber us at this point. So I'm in a very different
scheme's area. A scheme.
Exactly. But I'm in the schemest bit of Elgin as well, which is fine. Nothing ever happens. It's a big scary thing was like, oh, moving to Lismurdy because it's a bit dodgy. I mean, in the 4 years I've lived here, there was a gun hold up once, but it wasn't my square, so it was fine. It was just like 200 yards over. It's all good.
You don't want the people in your square. You like to keep them outside the square. I call it my circle.
But it was on Facebook Live. We were watching it like in our living room while it was happening a couple streets over. It was incredible.
I actually seen like quite recently here, there was, I don't know, some calamity that there was a mob at somebody's door, and there was people actually just sat with deck chairs, like, watching it, like, with cans in that. It was madness.
Sounds like brilliant entertainment. Our neighbours got a hot tub, which I know because they lively fill up the hot tub and lively speak about their hot tub. I'm fairly certain, though, they put up a wall, and I think, and I'm not 100% certain this is the reason, but I saw my neighbour get out of the hot tub from my bathroom window and turn to my wife and went, "Christ, I've never seen a whale beach before." And
a whale beach?
Yeah, a whale beach before. And I was thinking, maybe that's the reason why they put up a netting now. I can't see their hot tub because there's no classy way to get out of a hot tub, an inflatable one anyway.
No, to be honest, I'm usually one of the people that just gives up and falls. And the hot tub, usually, actually, to be honest, I'm one of the people that just stays away from hot tubs because they freak me out. Like, why would you go in a bath outside with your pals?
Yes, that's my exact point. Yeah, yeah. Everyone's like, oh, we should get one. No, I've got a bath.
I exactly. Like, or you could, even if you want to be like different, like Dean has a bucket. Dean likes to sit in a wee bucket of water from time to time. If you want to do that to get your kicks, yeah, just don't go for a bath with your pals.
Dean likes to get frozen. Speaking of the TNA podcast that we did.
Oh mate, he does, but he's always like, every podcast you hear him on, eventually just like, sorry about my sound, by the way, in his mad voice.
So the TNA podcast, how did myself, Kurt and Dean make the cut?
To be honest, it was actually yourself, Kurt and me that made the cut, because Dean messaged me and was like, because I posted a couple of tweets, because I found a bunch of old TNA content in their YouTube channel, so I was getting through this, and I just fell madly in love with TNA over this wee period and was tweeting about it a lot. And he messaged me and he was like, do you want to do a podcast about TNA since you're in about the start of that? And I was like, aye, I've run out of ideas for podcasts anyway, so that sounds spectacular. So then, I waited about 2 weeks because I'm very slow and procrastinate a lot. And then I just messaged you, and then it all came together well, for the most part, apart from obviously Dean freezing the whole time.
My camera decided to die. I tried to use the work computer. I did a big rejig of the wires to try and tidy it up, and it turned out that the webcam wire USB needed to go into the higher functioning one at the front. I did not know this. So once I moved it to the front, I was actually on screen more towards the end. But thankfully, I got in just in time before Dean froze, because I would have felt really like, I think I would have looked like a bit of a dick if it came up him frozen and just me with my logo, with my wee SWN logo, looking like a right big shot, going, no, I'm just plugging my stuff.
When I'm like releasing the podcast, I can just tag Dean Curtin in like a random burner account, and that can be what it was there, just exactly. Like the wee space, aye.
But no, I had a lot of fiber. It was almost perfect time, because I think I had must have had the same discovery around about the same time you did, finding lockdown and Slammiversary and that on TNA's YouTube.
It was genuinely like, see, because I've a very, very brief spell where I watched TNA regularly, which was around the time Drew showed up for obvious reasons, and then. So, like, I basically was getting reintroduced to an entirely different, like, sub-part of wrestling and, like, loads of it. So I was pure hyped, man. Like, the last time I was on this, we talked about Elix Skipper, and I had very little knowledge of him. And now, like, I kind of want to, like, message him, be like, do you want to be on the podcast? I didn't know who you were 2 weeks ago, but now I do, and I want to talk to you.
Tell me everything. Wow, I'm trying to think of that time. So what was it, 2015 or something like that, when Drew appeared, because it was when they were doing their Maximum Impact tour.
It was around the time of O'Dark the Great as well.
I think it was the year after. Year before was Grado versus Al Snow, I think, in Glasgow. And then,
yeah, I remember that.
Right about then time, something like that. O'Dark the Great, one of the best masked wrestlers of all time.
Oh, absolutely. Absolutely, no doubt in my mind. Not the best mask, because it covers maybe 3% of his face.
But I know. It's almost like they were like, mind Captain America, Mr. America.
Aye.
I think they could have done it a little bit. They could have paid a little bit more money and got a Captain, I keep saying Captain, Mr. America mask instead of the, it felt like you go on to TikTok and see 5 minute crafts, and it's like, here's a pair of my pants. I've now made a mask out of them.
There was a rumor that was actually Hulk Hogan under the mask, and I just thought that was really silly.
No, it was always Mr. America. I don't know where he is now.
His name's Arthur America.
What?
I don't know why Arthur came. I think I was thinking about the aardvark, but Arthur will do.
Arthur. Oh, all right. Mr. Arthur America.
He's on the tribute shows against Mandemkind.
Oh, yeah.
Cage match.
What, Well, I mean, of course, that's your money under the table once during all this lockdown time, podcasting and tribute shows.
Oh, it's time to make some real cash. It really is, because this, like, I'm the type of person that likes mountains on his walls. This life doesn't come cheap. I don't know why I just turned into the Supreme there. yes, absolutely.
For those that are listening to the feed and not watching our faces, yes, there is mountains in the background. As my collection of pops seem to be growing at an alarming pace.
I got some new ones. I got one that was the Mandalorian, and then it has like a wee floor that you zone, and then there's a tiny wee Grogu and a wee sleepy pod. Very cute.
Ah, super cute. Now there's a guy on Facebook that's selling them. He's selling his pops, and every time I go on, I'm just like, oh, I shouldn't. And then he only lives like. I said I mistimed my walk. I need to go get money at the same time. So I walked to the cash machine and then had to walk back down. But really, his house is about 10-minute walk from mine. So that's way too convenient to buy ridiculous pops. Like Razor Ramon was the latest one. And Trish Stratus and Charlotte Flair. So they were my latest additions to this ridiculous collection. Still waiting for Drew and Edge to turn up there. The pops, obviously. I mean, if they want to come to my house, they're more than welcome. My wife's a fan of both of them. So, Pro 2, that's the other thing that's really happened since we last chatted, on this podcast anyway. Your team with Big Benny, kind of semi-regular tag team partner, as The Silence. Okay, so we've had some technical difficulties already. So I mentioned The Silence and then that my internet crashed. So I think it's Big Benny's fault.
Maybe he's like, I wanted to be the 50th episode, therefore only I can talk about it.
But no, in the first 16 minutes we recorded before it died, we mentioned the Illuminati and The Silence and then just dead. So let's speak about safe things, safe topics. When I was looking for ideas, I tried to go for a little bit of a pun if I could think of one for segments. Like we've had Omar Mohammed's Omar or Nomar, where he picked things. If you don't know me by now, the horrific quiz edition of the podcast with the guys from Joe Hendry's school. I couldn't think of any because I wrote hide and seek. I thought that's really work in a podcast environment. Whereas you can just hide and I can't find you because I'm up in Elgin. And then I went.
That's just that on hard mode.
Just shouting, are you behind that mountain?
And then from here I shout no.
And then I just wrote hide and rake.
All I want. That's all I want is hide and rake. That'll do.
I didn't have any further ideas from that point. I just put hide and rake. That's funny.
Vince told me not to use my real last name. My name's actually Jason Heidenreich.
You're the son of Heidenreich and Michael Cole.
I got all of Michael Cole's wrestling ability though, and I got Heidenreich's height. I got the height for him.
I wouldn't say his tattoos also, but have you seen Michael Cole's tattoos?
Oh, the man's a specimen now though. Have you seen that? He got ripped.
He still shouts boss time, but you can tell he's just like,
I really like when you see him try with every fibre of his being not to say the big dog. He's like, it's the head of the table.
Oh, poor Michael Cole. I like Michael Cole. I think he gets a bad rap.
I mean, I hated him when he was doing his heel thing, like his whole I'm an uber heel commentator, but at the same time, I'm supposed to hate him, so I suppose it works out all right.
I liked his coal mine. Oh. This little fiberglass shell. I loved that. I thought that was a great idea. I wanted it in the office for where I work.
It was ahead of the curve because no places have that.
Like, Michael Cole, the original bubble.
What if Michael Cole did COVID? The conspiracies, Michael Cole is behind it because he owns a mask making company or something like that.
I bet he knows. He used to be a war correspondent. I bet he knows a thing or two.
about pathogens and such.
Exactly, and yeah, and best ways to protect yourself, coal mine, revolutionary.
You've seen it coming.
So well, I'll try to speak about the silence again. We'll attempt it. For Pro 2, so I've spoken to Logan Storm, who owns it, for an episode that's not out yet, but will be soon. He seems to be a man with plenty of ideas. Did he come to you with the idea of calling yourselves the Silence, or was there, what was the discussions like for that?
They actually, it was the opposite. So, like, me and Bennett, I think we had kind of discussed the idea of doing the tag team thing, like, no, I don't know the term for it, but like full time or something, like making an actual tag team of it, basically. And then once he said to us about that, the two of us were just like, right, we'll just go all in on it and come up with every idea and have plenty of kind of plans and put things into place. So like we're looking at looks and how we kind of compose ourselves. But that was the first thing we were doing, was basically just looking for cool wee references and things we were into that we could somehow link to the tag team name. So that's where we got the Silence for you, because I'm a big Doctor Who fan and there's the silence in Doctor Who. So that's where we got it for you. I hope BBC don't shut us down because they're listening.
Are you going to get an Ood mask to complete the look? Or
no, what I was going to do is I was going to get you can get a pencil pusher skirt with Cassandra's face on it. And I just thought that was maybe the one to go with fashion-wise, and pretend to be the Highlanders, but with Cassandra kilts.
That makes way more sense. I don't know why, when you said pencil pusher, I was thinking of, like, miniskirts that popped into my head.
I know, they do. That's the ones you get. I just don't make it a kilt.
I was just thinking, I might restrict your movement a little bit. But, yeah, I'm all in Doctor Who's not my thing. I think probably told you this last time. I like David Tennant.
Yeah, I was heartbroken.
Sorry, you weren't as heartbroken when I told Big Benny I didn't like Lord of the Rings. So it's
so you just basically you've took this tag team and you've hurt both our feelings. Me on two occasions.
I tried with Lord of the Rings. I really tried. I just find them incredibly boring. But Clerks 2 cemented it for me, and that was kind of now I can't watch it without thinking of Clerks 2.
I'm alright with Lord of the Rings. I do like it, but like, it's not my favourite thing in the world. It's one of those where like every so often I'll get in the mood to like binge them all, or binge all the Hobbit and all that. But like, I'm definitely edged more towards sci-fi than kind of. What is that? Is that like fantasy, I suppose you'd call it? But that's probably, like, yeah. I'm the other way unless it's D&D, but other than that, I'm mostly sci-fi.
Oh, I mean, on the flip side, I'll watch like a string of MCU films easily over a day. So just because I love them. So people will find them boring, and I'm not going to... I will not judge anyone for liking Lord of the Rings. It's just not my thing. I will say that. I'm not going to be a marquee wrestling fan going, well, you didn't like that, so you don't like real cinema.
The grief I've had as a wrestling fan for... Like, I love Roman Reigns, and I have had... I mean, to be fair, I did make the mistake of winning a Roman Reigns top 10 ICW show, so, like, fair enough, but, like... I don't know why it is with people that if they don't like something, they're just like, and by the way, everybody else has to hate it too. That's important. It's so weird to me.
Wrestling is so gatekeeper-y, it's ridiculous.
Oh, I know.
It's the worst. But I mean, I like John Cena. There was one point where I didn't like him, is where he stopped doing like the thug life pose, and he changed it to like the okay symbol, and I was like, fuck off, John. That's a bit...
You fucked it for everyone!
I hate that. Stop it. Stop it now. I even put through the Marine stuff. I didn't mind that at all. I liked the Marine film, the first one.
That's fair enough.
But yeah, that okay hand symbol, I was like, no, that's it, John. I'm done with you. But he's still... He's still one of the best.
I love how he basically evolved into JBL.
Yeah, he beat JBL at WrestleMania 21 and gained his hair 20 years. Like,
see how when they had
later.
That I Quit match all the year back? JBL was actually quitting his gimmick because Cena was taking it. He just used it whenever he fancied it. And now is the time, but see that clothesline for hell, it's like the...
Oh, the Hadouken, whatever thing he does.
Oh, it's so bad. I love it. So bad it's good, but it's not even... It's just bad.
Not bringing it into your repertoire when the show starts again.
I mean, I don't... If it takes John Cena to make it look even passable, I don't think I could make it look good. I'm not the hero for that. If you need a crisp drop kick, then I can maybe help you. But that's too much.
Oh man, but yeah, John Cena. I would love if he comes back and does a Hollywood Rock kind of JBL / thing for a bit, where he's just an absolute dick to everyone because he does movies.
I seen a guy, a wrestler, called Dan the Dad. And I just want John Cena to come back and do that gimmick, and it's literally like this guy's just a dad. He wrestles with glasses, a baseball hat on, and like tucked in shorts and all that, and it's fantastic. And that's what I want to see for Cena.
John the Dad, white socks and sandals.
Oh, exactly. Not just that. See, like the one with the actual flip flop bit, so that you have to like, push it through the sock, and it just looks so uncomfortable.
And his specialist weapon is like barbecue tongs.
Barbecue tongs and a sports whistle because he's the coach of the football team.
Of course, absolutely has to be
every time.
As that seems to be my look at the moment, I've kind of gone through phases during lockdown where I've been shorts guy for a lot of it, which I was quite happy with. And now joggy shorts guy. As of two weeks ago, Crocs.
I'm rocking a pair of them now. Crocs. I respect that hustle so much, man. My Instagram will lead everybody to know that I'm a weird sunglasses guy. But then I was doing it to the highest standards possible. Lewis Capaldi done it subpar. But obviously Lewis Capaldi's Lewis Capaldi. And I'm no Lewis Capaldi. So therefore everybody just was like, oh, it's a Lewis Capaldi hanging. I'm like, no. No, it's no. And then in my angry, angry Googles, right, I found out that not only has he stole that from me, he stole my birthday. Lewis Capaldi is coming for me. I don't know why in this episode I just keep jumping me sounding pure paranoid for some reason. I promise I'm no.
And for anyone listen to the Ben Carter episode, we've got Ronda Rousey here as well, to join.
Of course we do. I don't know what the hang is, right? I've never seen anything about her being problematic, but like I don't know what it is about her that makes me just think, do you know what? I don't like you. Don't talk to me.
I have the same feeling about Seth Rollins. Don't know what it is.
No, it's his mad laugh he used to do. I think that would ruin it forever.
Oh, I just look at him go, I'm just not having you at all. And that was before he took away the nation's, the wrestling world's sweetheart, Becky Lynch, for his own. But that was just couldn't stand him.
He wears a fine suit these days, though.
I'll give you that. His white and blue, like, paint merge number. Oh, that was...
Oh, I liked the leather one, I thought, like, because I was like, I've seen leather jackets. Everybody knows a leather jacket, and... Sadly, I need to mention, but as Krieger has made us all aware, leather trousers are very much still can be pulled off, but then to pull off a leather shirt and tie, Seth Rollins is a bold, bold man.
And he's still sticking with the one glove.
Ah, oh, you need to, I mean...
But who has his left glove?
Rue. That's his child, but also...
You know more about Seth Rollins' life than I do there. So I was like, who?
Rue is the name of Seth Rollins' child, but the way they've spelt it, it's also a cooking ingredient of flour and butter melted together. That's like, you know when you're making like macaroni and cheese, you mix flour and butter until it makes like that doughy pasty stuff? That's what they've called their child.
I just thought Rue the Day. It's like, Rue the Day...
No, that's why I'm going to have a child and call it, I don't know, tomato sauce or something. We ketchup. Ketchup Williams, ketchup. That's what I'm going to call it.
Ketchup's a great name.
I mean, I feel like if I was famous, I would definitely call my child something stupid just to make sure they had a rough time growing up like I did. Like you know, there's the people that called their child. I think it was the Coldplay guy. His daughter's called Apple. I'm not suggesting that by any means she deserves horrible things said there for having a name like Apple. But, like, you can't be surprised if folks say things to somebody called Apple. Like, what if they pee themselves? Ha ha, apple juice.
I mean, that's a name rotten to the core.
Oh, come on! Oh, so you knocked out at the park. I'll give you that.
I mean, you had me on the ropes there with apple juice. I was like, fuck, that's a pretty high bargain.
Fucking having that.
But, Craig or Wildo, the leather jocks, is that the word? I don't know. Always have been use it. They're Irish. Oh, I'm sure it's right. Are a thing, because he's now big sexy Kevin Nash.
Rocking them, aye. But to be fair, he showed us the trousers when he got them. But see how when he showed us them, he was just wearing the trousers with a t-shirt. So I was like, I don't like it, mate. But then when I see him in his gear, I was like, right, okay, I get it. I didn't get it before, but he's looking well. See, I've put him over, despite the fact that he's a scumbag. It doesn't put me over, but do you know what? Humility. That's why I'm here.
Okay, and in 2 hours, he only mentioned you once, and that was it. And we've only been on for a combined total of 20 minutes, and you've already put over his leather trousers.
That's all I'm putting over, though. He doesn't do anything else good.
So other things you've been up to, of course, you've been in the looking sharp dojo. I've been in one with Krieger. Because I mean, I'll go into the free ones because I find it's fascinating, but I don't think I'm going to get it much back from my tenor as someone who just does a podcast. I think it's more suited. That's for the wrestlers, the ones that are just like freebies. I'll jump into that. No bother.
No, they're really good, man. I don't know, it felt very weird that, like, at one point this thing wasn't there, and then all of a sudden he comes constantly with just somebody else, and you're like, how have you got this person? Like, that, I don't get how he'll just ask anything, and it seems to work.
Oh, I mean, Looking Sharp has got to be, like, one of the most hustling wrestlers
anywhere. Oh, yes.
So who've had so far? They've had as of recording, they've had Selena De La Renta, Buffa, and coming up again as of recording. Well, this is one that's coming out really quickly. It's going out like April 16th. I've got Kai Katana, Just Incredible, Hector Guerrero,
Bill James.
That's
what I'm looking forward to, man. I really liked him.
He definitely seems like your kind of style of guy. To learn from.
Aye. Like, he's like a big guy, but the guy can move. That's something I didn't appreciate when he was in NXT, because, like, I didn't really, because I was not wrestling at the time, I didn't, like, kind of go through wrestling with a fine-tooth comb that I do now, to see that this guy can, just because he's not doing flips, like, this guy can actually move for his robust size.
And I loved Bullfit. I thought it was hilarious.
Amazing. Like, it's one of the ones where if it get pitched to you, you'd hate it. You'd need to see it to be like, right, that's fantastic.
So, how many times, because you seem to be quite the one that'll just say whatever you're thinking, how many times have you told not to bring up Gobbledygooker for the Hector Guerrero one?
It's a regular. I think he's got like a timer set on his phone to just message us certain, like me and Craig and I'd be like, nobody bring up the turkey. Or I swear, that's it. No bookings for me. And I'm like, you don't have a company. He's like, no bookings. And the Looking Sharp Online Dojo of Excellence. He always misses out the of excellence part. But he refers to it as the Dojo of Excellence.
So, pretty much. If we'll know that if one of you has mentioned the Gooker, because you have no bookings forever, you'll be in Dundee.
You'll be. I love it. I absolutely love it. Or you'll be Jason Hyde, to be fair, because I'll get no bookings anyway. I'll like somebody will find my Twitter, go on my podcast, and be like, I'm not having this guy in the locker room. He sounds like he'll annoy everybody.
It's supposed to be a wrestling podcast, and he interviews a band. What the fuck's this?
Oh, mate, I know. I remember hanging out at the time. I was like, this is a this will go on Spotify in the sports charts. And then it's a band. I didn't think that through, but it was actually to Craig's dismay, it was my most viewed or listened to episode. I think it's because I had four people sharing it instead of just the one.
But, I'll probably do it. Yeah, I enjoyed it. I mean, like I said before, I've listened to all of them. So I didn't listen to mine because I don't like the sound of my own voice. In fairness,
no, I get that. I hate listening. Like, see, when I'm actually like editing them and that, like I will go to parts that I know it's not me talking and stuff because I hate my voice.
Oh, I mean, I don't even edit. That's why I don't. The only bit I'll check in this one when I put it out will be how far we got along before the internet died. And then that's it. I'll put it all together.
See how fluid you can make it. That's kind of what I do as well. Oh, I can only sound edit, though. Video editing was never something I was good at, which is annoying because it's something I would make the best memes in history with.
I would love to be able to do either. I just don't. So when you come back saying I run a more professional podcast, I don't. I just I top and tail it and put it out. I don't think about anything else. But at least
you have a nicer accent. That's what makes it sound more professional.
I don't seem to have an accent. I think that's why. It's like there's some Scottish somewhere in it. But
I've been told that I sound like. If Ravy Davy dressed up like a goth for Halloween, is one I've been given. But most, I say that it's usually Miss Trunchbull that I get as well.
I think I did a wee cameo on Hitting the Headlines. So it's a Northern Irish podcast. It's run by a Scotsman, Kurt Cooper. But I did a wee cameo, like do a Vince McMahon impression, tell them to get him any listens or you're fired. And they just said I had a fake Irish accent. I
was like, fuck off. Don't have a real Irish accent either. But I mean, exactly. Technically speaking, you don't have a real Irish accent. So technically speaking, it is a fake Irish accent. It just wasn't the intentions.
I was doing my best. The accent is just, I don't know how it's happened. I don't think anyone could place where I'm from. But which is great, because that means I can almost sound... coherent and all that kind of thing. I'm not like, it's a problem when I speak to guys like Scotty Swift or Aberdeen folk, because I'm up in this end. It can get a little bit muddled in the middle where it gets thicker and thicker, and it just becomes I really like Dean Ford, but becomes just a Dean Ford podcast, yeah. Where you don't understand what's happening, but you know words are being said somewhere.
Oh, you know, I know exactly what you mean. Like, see, sometimes Dean's what, like, I'll often, like, be like, right, what'd you just say? And then see while he's repeating it, I've already figured out in my head what he said. And then, like, the whole conversation is like, I'm two-thirds behind on it. That's kind of what happens with me. But I don't know why, because, like, I just sound regional to where I am. I don't know why the looking like a girl thing sets people off, but people feel really weird. When they hear me talk and be like, why are you not telling me you're the Dark Lord of whatever it is you're the Dark Lord of? Like, it's so weird, I don't know.
Well, at least you're not at the other end of it where it's like seeing kids and you just go around going, rawr, and all that.
Imagine
kind of
that,
stuff.
Like a pure wee, like, bam in a Burberry hat, get up to fucking being, rawr means I love you in dinosaur. That would be amazing.
Oh, my skin is just fucking crawled. Thought of that.
Somebody once waved at me when I was going by Four Corners in Glasgow where all the goths hang out, and I genuinely, like, that was a genuine turning point in my life where I was like, I can't even know folk that cut about Four Corners. Like, I can't be somebody that, like, even to know their names isn't acceptable.
I was so excited when I've only actually been in Glasgow, like, for anything once. Just went down there for a couple of days, and when my wife told me about Four Corners, I was like, all right, that sounds interesting. And she's like, stood me there going, this is Four Corners. I thought it was like a fat man's dream. I was just like going, there's so many places to eat. There's four places to eat, but there's so many.
One on every corner.
One on every corner.
Good Lord.
How did this happen? I thought I'll be fine. I'm not going to be. It's Glasgow. It's not like it's a huge city and the whole remit things, but I've never felt so much like a country bumpkin by going down there. Going, oh, this is like, oh, there's so many cars and people and oh, there's so much things. There's a Greggs, and then it only got topped when I went down to London, and I thought, oh, this is scary. This is scarier now, because two times I've went down to London, there's been a terrorist attack the same week.
Oh.
Well, actually, the second time, there was a terrorist attack when I was in London. So, I'm laughing, but maybe when someone got, I think they were stabbed on the bridge.
And is that when the person stabbed him with a narwhal tusk?
Oh, I hope so, but it was... I don't hope so, but that sounds amazing.
No, somebody, it was like a citizen, I think it was actually somebody out in day release for the jail, but that could be, I could have made that part up while I didn't care about the mids of the conversation, but I feel like I definitely remember the guy that was stabbing somebody on the bridge.
It was was it 2-3 years ago, maybe?
It's all adding up to being the person that gets stabbed with a narwhal tusk.
Wow.
Or narwhal, narwhal. I don't know how to say that.
I know what you mean, it's fine. But yeah, I was on the tube at the time, and I got off at Buckingham Palace, because I thought, well, I'm down here. I'm no royalist by any stretch, but I'm in London. I want to go see the big houses.
You went in Rome, you go, I know.
So I got out of the tube, and my phone was going off, going to my mum, going, where are you? There's a terrorist incident. Oh, where? Well, London Bridge. Sorry, I'm at Buckingham Palace. If there's going to be a safe spot, this will be it. If I'm anywhere else, maybe it's a bit scarier. But I'm where the Queen is, so, and I'm old enough to not be of any worry to any other royal. So it's all good. I'll be absolutely fine. Yeah, but I've never seen a gun that size before until I went to the airport in London during that 2 weeks, and holy
fuck. Aye, they're sat there with the choppers, man.
Oh, man. I felt...
It looks like they've got to hold them sideways.
But, I didn't take anything from the shop, but as soon as I saw the gun, I was like, did I take something? Did I steal something?
You're like, if I stole something, I'm like... See, even though I have never even attempted to smuggle anything out of this country... Never in my life even had anything in my bags that could be construed as not having supposed to be there. But every time my bags come through that scanner, I'm just like, there's no explosives in there, is there? Where is my iron? I don't know why, I always get pure paranoid and be like, oh, I'm going to get arrested.
I hate it. And then your brain does their thing where, well, when I was going to Disneyland, I didn't pack my bag. My wife did, because I don't get trusted to do that kind of thing, because I'll just go with absolutely nothing that I need. And when they went, oh, did you pack this yourself? My brain automatically went, well, you didn't, so say no. And then I thought, probably better not to say no. No, I better say yes. I think that'll just stop things that not going wrong. Prince went, no, you didn't pack that at all. You've got to be honest with these people. No, but they'll stop me. That was also the same trip where, no, that wasn't actually, the London one with the terrorist attack. I went through the scanner at the same time as someone else, so it didn't register me going through. So for 40 minutes, I was walking around Terminal 5 unregistered, and technically I should not have been there. They had to look through CCTV to make sure I actually went through the scanners.
Aye, that's like some national security shit, isn't it?
It was a bit scary. I've seen the big guns already. There's been a stabbing, and I'm standing at Terminal 5 going, well, I definitely went through the scanner, so I don't know what I can do at this stage. So they had to look through CCTV, and you know what? Bald head and bearded is a common look everywhere. Yeah. So, took them fucking ages. I was the last one on the plane, and I don't think the pilot knew why I was, or captain, knew why I was late, and I just went, oh, they finally found me. And I could tell in his eyes, he looked at me and went, you've just been standing around at the duty free getting drunk, haven't you, you prick? And I'm just like, no, I just thought I was a terrorist for a minute. It's all good.
See, there was, when I was in, when I was in America for Mania, there was a school shooting, and it was, I can't remember what one, but it was a relative, I don't want to say fate, infamous is the word. It's one of the kind of more well-known ones. And my mum phoned me very frantically and was like, are you all right? Did you see it? And did it happen? And I was like, what? What are you talking about? And she was like, there was a shooting at a school. And I was like, whereabouts? She was like, Arkansas. And I was like, right. So firstly, I'm in Florida. And secondly, even if I was in Arkansas, why would I be in a school? Like, why would I go to school in Arkansas to get shot? It makes, oh, they're just, mums are weird.
Well, unless you are the shooter. But yeah.
I suppose that is a reason I'd go to a school. Know that I'm a school shooter.
That's the
metal clip. Think I'd need to. That's how you can promote that. By the way. Hi, my name is professional wrestler and internet darling Jason Hyde, and I can confirm that I am not a shooter of schools, public places, anywhere in between. Thanks for listening to this message.
And then I'll use my amazing editing skills to take out that knot, and then we'll be all good to go. Right, I'll just ask this one out of the way, just because it's the only one left on my shit notes here. Other than the finale, which I'm very excited by, which will only translate well in the video episode, so hopefully people watch it. What would win in a fight, two sheep or one cow?
Right, so I actually heard Lou speak about this, and I have to say the one cow, but the reason being, it's not even like a tactical decision that. The reason that I say that is because I'm absolutely terrified of sheep. Like, I have a genuine phobia of sheep, right? I wouldn't do well up your neck of the woods at all. Because, like, I don't know why. I think it's because I was on a school trip. Let's see the ones where you stay, like, a week and do, like, outdoorsy things, which is horrible enough as it is. But, like, I was going down this hill on a bike, and there was no storm, and I felt horrible, but I went into this sheep's face, bike first. And I was like, oh no, sorry, sheep turned round. This sheep was, firstly, unscathed, absolutely fine, and secondly, it chose violence, and it attempted to kill me. It tried to murk me on the spot, and I have just been terrified of them ever since. So, for that reason, I cannot take their side, so cow. Till I'm dead, till I die.
I have a just fear of chickens for a similar reason.
Aye, they have claws that can take your eyes out. That's absolutely reasonable.
Well, that, and I was in Orkney on a family holiday, a holiday where I bought my first Chris Jericho action figure, so that's what I remember it for, mainly. But we're out, and there was these chickens. All good to go, it's fine, they're chickens. He gives a shit about chickens. And my dad, in his infinite wisdom, started throwing apple cores at my feet. So I got chased by chickens for far longer than I should have, and I had to jump into, like, the window. I couldn't get to the door because they blocked the door. So I had to go and, these are organized chickens, so I had to go through a window to get into the house to get away from them. And since then, I've just got a fear. I'll eat them.
But, I see, before you'll eat a nugget, do you just, like, kind of, like, dip it in the sauce and be like, fuck you?
I think there is. I think that's why I like chicken so much. I think it's, like, a bit of satisfaction going, I've eaten one of your cousins, you prick, for chasing me back when.
See your great-great-great-great-great-granddad that's fatal Orkney. Fuck them.
Right, we'll go to the fan questions. We've got four, and we've got three, because I can't count. Big Benny, speaking of Big Benny, as we have done many a time in this podcast, he's put, you can have any band or artist play to the ring, but it can't be one of their songs they play. Who do you choose and what tune?
Right, so I'm trying to get the best combination I can have. So, right, I figured it out. I have a caveat though, is this in a live or dead situation or just alive? I'd assume just alive, because then they can actually sing me out.
Yeah, that probably makes sense, yeah.
Right, well, that puts BB King out the window then, so I'm going to go for Ozzy Osbourne doing Singing in the Rain from the musical, because I just think that would be really funny.
In the style of Black Sabbath, or would you want him going do 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 do?
In the style of some 80s electro pop. Just for an added level of why is this happening?
I guess he could stand there singing and have a keytar. Just
exactly. And like he can see how like his hair can look plastic like a hat. Like he's for the future, even though he's for the 80s.
Yeah, I'm imagining it now, and it's a terrifying thought. I was thinking just like, I don't know. So, what songs they play? I would have Fozzy, just because it would just be funny to see Chris Jericho there and not actually wrestling. And I don't know, just singing some sort of nursery rhyme.
Wait, no, actually, I've changed my answer. Susan Boyle in her own style. I don't want to be too explicit on this because I know we're allowed to swear, but see the Cannibal Corpse song, Entrails Ripped from something or other? That, Susan Boyle doing an operatic rendition of that, please.
That's got money written all over it. Grado could chip in. Grado could chip in. She could do Like a Prayer the same night. Done.
Aye, that, see, to be fair, that's better than most music festivals I've been to. And I've only been to like two, to be fair, so the bar's not very high.
Oh, I went to one, and it was a Wizard festival, which sounds amazing. It wasn't. Headline at the Stranglers.
No idea who that is.
Only which I only two songs, Golden Brown and something else.
I do know that. That sounds absolutely hellish. See, to be fair, my ones were just two downloads. And the first one, actually... it was the second one. That was it. I had started training maybe 2 or 3 months before it. And then I seen another wrestler. I seen Stone Malone, and his name's Alan. And I was shouting Alan at him. But then everybody just thought I was doing that mad gopher video. So they were going, Steve! And I was like, no, I'm trying to get a guy called Alan's attention. But then see, because everybody had been doing that the whole weekend, everybody, including Stone, just started shouting Alan. So I was like, do you know what? I give up. I'll talk to him in his training. That'll do.
Was it you that saw Dean at WrestleMania, but you didn't actually go together? Am I remembering that?
Yeah, right. So it was like, see that Kevin Bridges thing where he's like talking about seeing somebody like, what t-shirt are you wearing? Like that. It was like that. I phoned him. And then he was like, I was like, where are you sitting? And he took a picture of the ring for where he was. And then I took a picture of the ring for where I was. We figured out, we looked at each other and he's went, I see you. And I was like, all right, good. And he just went, hey, you're a dick, bye. And that was it. That was the only interaction we had the whole time.
The other questions I've got is Stone Malone, speaking of, Alan. You know? What's his favourite kind of wheel? So what's your favourite kind of wheel?
Wagon wheel, but specifically the biscuit and not the thing that makes a wagon go.
Are you a fan of the blue one or the red one? Have you got a particular wagon wheel favourite?
I'm colourblind, but the one
shit. Do you like the grey one or the not so grey one? I don't know what like the reboot is here.
The one with jam in it. I like the one with jam in it. I think that's the blue one, but I could be wrong. So bring me, pal.
That is the blue one. That's not the first time I've had that problem. But one of my best friends for work, he's colourblind, and it's the same as blues. Blues all look the same. So we got this big thing in going, it was all like purples and blues, and he had to just call me over and went, right, be honest, are they all different colours? I went, yeah. They all look blue. they're not.
But my girlfriend's mum got her bathroom redone, like she has a second bathroom down the stair, and like she got it painted a different colour and she showed us. She was like, oh, it looks like my bathroom. And I was like, what did she do? Why is it different? It looks, is it nice? Do we like it? I love it. Brilliant. It did, to be fair, it's a nice house, so I'm assuming the bathroom's a nice colour.
Did you go through the, I'm assuming, I think I see my colours all right, but as soon as you say someone, you're colourblind, they spend the rest of the interaction going, colours that?
Either that or they'll say to me what colours, it's always a fire engine for some reason, but what colours a fire engine? And I'll just be like, oh, purple, I don't know. But no, like, it's, mostly I think it's just that I need to remind, because unless you need to remind people that you don't actually know what the colour they're talking about, like, you don't realise how much colour comes into daily conversations. Especially because, like, my girlfriend's one of the pure, she has, like, I see, like, every earring she has is dead dangly, and she has, like, 1,000 of the things, and, like, they're all different colours, and she's like, do you like this one or this one? And I'm like, she's holding the exact same thing, but they're different colours, and I'm like, we'll go with the right, we'll go with the right hand side. Whatever one's on the right, wear it. That'll do you.
I'm assuming that's not anything that really comes into play when you're doing the wrestling. Unless, I don't know, you're doing I can't think of anything that would come into play. Unless you're doing on a pole match, you have to get the right thing.
But if I get signed by WWE, I wouldn't know if I was on Raw or SmackDown unless I looked at the sign.
You come out and go, oh, can't wait to be on Raw. Oh, it says NXT. What the fuck's
happening? I know that. Gala especially, I'd be like, there's no even ropes there. I mean, if I went to Josh Barnett's Bloodsport, I'm lost. I don't know where I am or what I have today.
This is, again, another great segue. For Brent's question, he put, Vince calls you, I'm not a fucking child. Vince calls you, brackets, finally, and he says he wants to sign you, but it's because he's bringing back the Mixed Max Challenge and he needs a partner for Ronda. What do you do?
Joe, I seen that question and I was like, the thing is, like, Ronda's good. It's not a professional disdain. It's purely personal. I don't even know why I don't like her. But I feel like Shawn Michaels and Marty Jannetty hated each other. I don't hate Benny. I think he probably hates me, but I don't hate Benny. So, like, you know, you get the tag teams that don't like each other. But I just don't think I could be a part of Ronda winning anything. Like, I couldn't do that to myself. I'd be like, I'm going against someone, I believe. So I'd say Vincenzo, because I'm allowed to call him that because he listens to my podcast and we're on first name terms. I'd be like, Vinny Mac from the Big Punchy Attack Shack. No. And then I'd hang up the phone.
I thought the first time you said that. Is it? Have you actually been called by Big Vinny Mac from the Big Fight Shack?
No, I've never been. It was William Regal did phone me, but and I was like, listen, I'm not interested, right? Don't phone me in an English accent and ask. And then they're like, right, we'll get Drew to phone him. Drew phones. And I was like, Drew, don't phone me in an American accent and ask.
get out here with your fake Irish accent and.
Exactly. You're next. They'll be phoning you up asking me to do the Mixed Max Challenge. Although I do think they should bring that back because I did enjoy it.
We've got some classic things. We've got Team Little Big. I'm trying to remember anything from it. Alexa Bliss and Braun.
The
fun.
The Empress. The Emperors of Awesome or something, was it? Miz and Asuka or something like that.
They won it. I think the first one.
That's pure money, to be fair. It was a weirdly good mix. Carmella and Big E as well. They were a team. I don't remember if they were good, but they were a team.
They're definitely a team. So who would be your if Ronda's like, that's fine, you can come with our partner, who would it be?
See, that's actually a difficult one. I'm trying to keep who my favourite WWE women's wrestler is that I could team up with, because there's so many, but like there's many that I do like, I just would probably not work well with them, so I'm going to go with Shayna Baszler. She's my favourite women's wrestler in WWE. I love her. So, Shayna Baszler. Plus, if I'm on her team, she can't hurt me.
I mean, really...
if she pulls me up for talking bad about Ronda, I'll be like, Shayna, shut up or I'll slap the gum shield at you. I wouldn't actually say that because she'd kill me, but you know what I mean?
I really like that Shayna Baszler's nickname, Ace of Spades, wherever she is. It's not even like it's a badass reason. It's because she could do card tricks.
That's amazing. See? And I would never have known that until I became a partner in the Mix Max Challenge. I cannot say that word. I keep saying Mix Max. Match. Matched. I go there.
But she'd be like, just calm you. Just like, right, we're going to go out and beat up, I don't know. Try to think of anyone. Every wrestler's went out of my head. Seth Rollins and, I don't know, Peyton Royce. But before that, is this your card?
Listen, just so, have you got all your spots remembered? Yes, Shayna Baszler, I do. All right, very good. Pick a card, pal. Don't know why she became as schemy as I am, but that's that.
But all that and our Raw talk when she was with R-Truth, she spent 3 weeks trying to get him to eat. I think it was like a seafood sauce mix with hot sauce in it. She's just an absolute dork outside the ring, but you wouldn't say it to her face because she can also kick the living shit out of you.
I mean, see on Up, Up, Down, Down as well, she just slays folk, man. Like, she's just like beating folk with absolute ease every time I've seen her on it. But then, except for Jessamyn Jukes, he seems to always beat her, which, right, this is a weird thing because it's not like a bad, I don't know if it's like looks like, but see Jessamyn Jukes, she makes me think of a giraffe. Like, I think she just has a long neck, so every time I see her, I just think about a giraffe. So I kind of take her seriously.
She's got that, like, she's clearly very fit, and again, we kick a little show you, but yeah, she's like really stretched. Lanky.
Aye, when I say I can't take her seriously, I don't mean like as a person. I mean like she's like all walking all badass. Like, I don't mean like I want to see her CV for like assurance. Like she's like this badass like mental shoot fighter woman, but I'm just like giraffe.
Would you bend the rules to try and get Savio Vega? Savio Vega, it's coming out after WrestleMania. I am absolutely 100% sure Savio Vega is going into the Hall of Fame this year.
Honestly. If Savio Vega goes into the Hall of Fame, I'll do a celebratory weird internet there. That's what you can have for it, because I need him in there. He deserves it more. Right, let's look at Kane, right? Kane's good, but is he not like an American Tory for a start? Plus, what's he really done? Choke slams and that? I can do choke slams. Are we looking at RVD on the merits of having two really good looking girlfriends, he can join us as well, right? But
he was actually the only person that's killed Impact because they got pulled for his it was some sort of sex celebration with Katie Forbes.
But like they're all doing their things. All I'm saying is that they didn't change wrestling. Savio Vega changed wrestling because he made me like wrestling and I'm the best wrestler in the world, so I think he deserves his spot.
But it's appeared too many times now to not be put in this year. Surely.
He can still go, man. That's what blows my mind. Is it, he's actually still, like, it's not like, I don't want to, like, see anyone in particular. Like, see when you see folk that are getting on in years and it's, like, they're in that weird middle ground of, like, they're no past it, but they're not in their prime. Like, see, like, that area. He's not even hot that yet. He's still just phenomenal. This has just got to become me gushing over Savio Vega for the next 5 hours. Buckle up, kids.
The internet might die before then, so I'm sorry. But it might be this is the second coming going, oh, fuck, he's already mentioned Illuminati and the silence. That's it. Savio Vega chat. Just cut it off. Done.
End it. Shut it down.
But no, I don't think I wasn't really around for Savio when I started watching anyway, so the only bits I'm seeing him is he's kind of a bit of a running joke. Like, who are you going to call if you need a fill spot? Savio. Just get
Reliability. Just pure reliability. He's a He's like, I'm the unprofessional wrestler. He is my antithesis. Because, like, he's just a consummate professional, the greatest in-ring worker that's ever lived, bar myself. And a handsome fella into the bargain. Get him in the Hall of Fame.
Again, when you're getting these warnings not to speak about gobbledygooker, is this your fireback going, I want to speak about it if you get Savio on the dojo?
I mean, the first seminar he did was just a Lou seminar. And he was asking us, like, who would like to get in and things. And I was like, Savio Vega. I want him. I need Savio Vega seminar. And it's a, like, every time anybody says that, I always ask for Savio Vega. But, like, now it's a real possibility. So hopefully we can make that happen. And then I can interrupt the entire seminar and just be like, I love you, Savio! And then act pure blank face so they can't tell who it was.
Oh, my camera's not working. My camera's not working. Savio! Savio!
Follow me, Twitter!
Who's that speaking? Shit!
It's not at Jason Hyde PW, but you should check him out as well.
He's off a fine.
That was amazing, your accent. He's off a fine. I love it.
How weird was that thing though? When was the Undertaker thing happen? No, it hadn't. When like everyone turned up in their suits and that, and then Kane showed up in his gear, and then they all disappeared, and the Undertaker turned up.
That was amazing. That was so good. Like, that was pre-recorded. How did Kane know to figure it out? It was like, it's bad enough to, if you think about it, right, it's bad enough when you're in a live crowd, but, like, imagine being, like, take the live crowd away. How did they know just burst out laughing at him the whole time?
I just feel it. It's like backstage, Kane's last one turned up going, ah, fuck. Everyone's there. I mean, he probably saw the Godwins first, thinking, that's fine, they're in the dungarees. That's all right, everyone else is part of this. And then he sees, like, fucking Kevin Nash and, like, Rikishi. And Jeff Hardy.
He sees Kevin Nash, he's running about going, where's these leather trousers? Where are they? Oh, is it Krieger's thing now? All right, okay.
I don't know why I came to my head, but I thought, that was Flex Hunter's thing first, and now it's Krieger's.
Billy Kirkwood, right, who is a legend of every single facet of existence, once referred to him as Sexy Flexy. Oh my, I've never been able to see past Sexy Flexy. I don't even think he's a bit anymore, Big Flex.
I think he is, no.
Oh my god, I just, every time I seen him, I was like, Sexy Flexy. That's it. Love him. Big fan.
Billy Kirkwood, yeah, he's just, that and Sexy Flexy, of course. But yeah, Billy Kirkwood's just one of the absolute best. I'd have him on a podcast in the future, but he seems to be doing everything. I don't think I'd ever get a spare hour with him.
I really wanted to have him in my podcast, but I was too scared to ask him because I don't know him. So I was like, I'll get one eventually. And now I don't have the weekly thing, so I can just take a wee while to work up to it and be like, right, get Billy Kirkwood on the podcast. Let's go!
Speaking of that, trying to find guests. I mean, finding guests is not that much of an issue. Like, I've got like a little bit of a backlog of people to contact, but then I've got folk that I can't really contact that want to be on because they're wrongins. So I'm trying to ignore them at the same time. But yeah, I went through a weekend thinking, fuck it, I'm just gonna contact Drew follows me on Twitter. I'm gonna fucking email Drew. Yeah. How can I get you on the podcast? Oh, here's the boys, here's my contacts email him. Fine, cool. Still absolutely baffled why you're still tweeting me back, but okay. Contacted them and they were like, no, you're not getting Drew. All right, okay. Fair enough.
Bye then.
You might get, I don't think I've said it on our podcast who I was offered, but I was offered someone else. And I was like, okay, that's all right, cool. Then they asked for my listening figures. So I gave them that and I haven't heard from them again since.
I mean, I got like, I think the most kind of, most of the people that I asked were people that either knew or thought they seem all right enough to the point where they'll let me, like, they'll be on even though they don't know me. So I never actually branched out to any kind of bigger guests, except for I tried so hard and got so far, but in the end, no, I'm joking. I tried to get Peter Capaldi. And he's like a 62-year-old man. He doesn't have Twitter and all that. So, like, I got to his, I managed to get through his agent, and she was like, oh, I like saying things like this, so what old days will keep you in mind for availability? And I was like, cool, that's cool. And then, like, to my weird, strange dismay, they actually get back to me and just were like, it was like a holding message of that, he's still doing stuff, he's still busy. But then, a wee while later, I found out that Suicide Squad was happening. And I was like, I can't believe that. I'd get turned in for Suicide Squad. Why do I feel important because of that? Like, I was like, yeah, you should just tell me it was Suicide Squad and I stopped annoying you, pal.
So instead of working with the second greatest wrestler of all time, he's going to work with John Cena instead.
Yeah, Suicide Squad,
which looks exactly amazing. Because it's got James Gunn directing it, I was kind of like going, I think I'll see this, because DC films have just not been good to me. Cause...
I mean, the Snyder Cut, though, have you seen that?
Oh, load of shit.
Oh, you're off your nut. I don't like long hangs like that, but honestly, I was like, this is the fastest 4 hours of my life.
Oh,
then it started doing an exist. Honestly, I loved it. But, like, I have a full DC sleeve and stuff. Like, I'm a mark for them.
Oh, yeah.
So, like,
okay.
I was one of the folk that, like, I took the day off working things. I was buzzing. It was worth it, I hope.
I'm not back to the Lord of the Rings stuff. I'm not going to judge anyone for liking it, like what you like. But, nah, I just couldn't. I watched it, and I was just like, fuck, it's only been 30 minutes. There's already been like three slow-mo bits here. What the fuck's happening? Come on. Let's just...
I know. That is the one thing I would have said, is that it is a bit stop-start because of the length of it, but like, usually like, I'm totally cool with like big, long, drawn-out things as long as I can kind of make time for it, but like, it was a good investment. It worked out at the time. It paid off. I didn't feel like I wasted my life. Unlike when I bought 2K Battlegrounds, what a regrettable decision, because I was punishing Finn Balor. I was making an example of him, and then all of a sudden he's like strap kick you into an alligator's mouth, and I'm like, where in the rules of professional wrestling does it say, all right, 5 second rope break, 10 second count out, if they put you in the alligator's mouth you lose? It's no crazy golf. I just don't.
I got that for Christmas, to be fair, I found it and I got it. I went, right, just give me that for Christmas. I may have to play it now, so it was my own fault. But like, I think I would have been all right with it being absolute shit if like I got a little bit of achievement out of it, like a platinum trophy or something like that, because I'm on PS4. And I looked at the trophy thing and I was like, I'm not even a fucking platinum out of this. What am I earning from playing this? Fucking nothing.
What have I learned apart from the fact that this was a terrible decision?
I'll stick to Supercard. Fuck this. I'm not playing anymore.
What I particularly like, right, is that there was it has Rob Gronkowski in it, but like before, obviously, he was like, oh no, I'm totally coming to WWE. Psych! And then just didn't he go to the WWE? Like, that was that. I like that. And there's some guy in it called Lahim Lillard. And I googled him and I genuinely still couldn't find out who he was.
I think he's like in the other 2K NBA Battleground.
One of those sports things. Ball people.
One of those. But yeah, it's not good. I got halfway through the story mode. I really wanted to keep going because like Scotland's one of the phases. I think that's be quite cool. We'll get to, I don't know, punch someone into Nessie. Oh, fuck knows. But no, I haven't got Jake Snake Robert. Roberts keeps beating me in gauntlet matches, so he can go fuck himself. That's just...
Oh, I know, like, it's not just that, man, like, half of them look nothing like their people. Like, honestly, see if some of the names weren't there. Right, firstly, I thought that Christian was Benoit, so that's... I don't know if you can, like, nukes that word out of there if you need to, but I thought Christian was Benoit. I thought that Shawn Michaels as well, I thought was flying Brian Pillman. Why flying Brian Pillman would be in that game, I don't know, but I thought he was there. Like, some of them just don't look anything like it. But, like, the idea's good. I think they've just done it very wrongly.
Did you play any of the five-star wrestling games?
I did. I played the one that had Uncle Andy Organ instead of Randy Orton. And no, it's Andy Organ and Uncle Curtis Angel.
And Ragnar Brock.
It had Harvey D.
Harvey D.
Oh, what was the? There was a Goldberg one as well.
Iceberg
was the one. I played Fire Pro Wrestling World. But I literally just used that for a weird kind of disciplinarian thing over my pals, because I made all my pals like the ones that aren't even. Literally don't care about wrestling at all. I made them on this game, and then see every time they would annoy me, I'd just be like, right, I've been on to Fire Pro Wrestling World and I've deleted your thighs. You can get your thighs back when you can start behaving yourself. Alright. And then like my pals were getting proper worked up. They were like, no, I want thighs. I look like an idiot, I look like Rayman. But they never got their thighs back for their behaviour.
I downloaded that so excited because I saw people going absolutely mental for this game, and I started playing it going, I have no fucking idea what's happening here. And I went through the tutorial and just got really annoyed. Just going, I flicked up that thing at the right time. Fuck you. Let me do the moves.
So I went on the promoter one, the Fire promoter. I don't really play the actual wrestling part of it. I just love the promoter one because it's like... It's like LGM mode. It's very much like that, and it's so good. I like that. I was going to stream it. I keep saying I'm going to stream, and then I keep not for no reason other than I'm really lazy. And no day in.
Well, if the podcast bit's winding down, then we're going to cycles of lockdown cycles. So obviously we're coming back into the Twitch bit. Of the cycle. Now we're a year into lockdown.
I'll restart the podcast, and then I need to add another thing in the middle, though. Oh no, because that's where the Twitter poll tournaments come in.
Of course,
that's
yes.
Another phase of the year. Which yeah. I'm already going over in the next one. We're determined on that. It's happening. I'm glad you agree.
I'm still waiting for nine folk to get in. I think eventually, if it gets to like just before it starts, I'm just going to just randomly pick nine people, go, right, fuck it, you're in. That's it. We're starting this now.
Can you put actual Sabio Vega in it, or will he be upset about it?
You know what? We're putting Sabio Vega in.
Yes!
I don't know where he's going to turn up.
But... I really hope he doesn't turn up against me, because... I just couldn't live with myself. I mean, I would do it, no bother, I would ice him, but still, I would be slightly upset for a few seconds.
I just don't want him to go out early to, like, Big Benny, then.
Aye, that would be bittersweet, because then I'd need to put Big Benny out. It would really, so many horrible outcomes are coming into my mind right now. Very terrifying times we live in, tumultuous.
So I think that's all the questions I've got. The TNA podcast, so is these roundtable ones, are you thinking of doing other subjects, getting other folk on? What's your kind of plans with that?
Yes, so I've been chatting about... usually what happens is that like I'll talk to the people and say to them and kind of try and figure out a subject if I don't already have one. I think the next one I want to do is wrestling video games, and just like a wrestling video game discussion. Don't know who we or when... I'm literally that disorganised, but I think it's going to be just like every so often I'll put one of them out, every so often I'll put the Attempt to Socialise format on of like just like basically similar to this and fuck about. I just kind of do what I want, and it's not really like I'm glad that people enjoyed it, and because I got like so many nice messages and all sorts of, but basically like, folk were saying that they really enjoyed it, and that was really nice. But like, I'm no putting it out to be good. I'm genuinely just putting it because I have nothing better to do and I enjoy it, and it kind of gives me a chance to talk to my pals or make pals, and I literally just used it for that. But then I stopped doing it very briefly. I say very briefly, it was like for a good month. I stopped doing it, and then in that time, like, I'd made it quite like I'd made it no secret. It was like personal stuff going on. Like, I was like losing a family member to cancer, so I was like, right, I'm not going to do any of that for a bit. And then like folk were just messaging me, like, know that I'm be like, oh, feel bad for me, but like they were like skipping past the whole actual serious personal issue and be like, oh, I get me on your podcast, pal. And I was like, you've just soured it for me now. So it really annoyed me for a wee while. But now I'm just like, I enjoy it again after doing the last few ones. So it might pick up again at one point, but then I'm just kind of enjoying figuring one out that I want to do, doing it, putting it out, and then like kind of hoping maybe that could even be good for the quality of it. Because I can spend more time on each one instead of like putting one out and then having to start on the next one. I can actually kind of space them out and make them good, but it's kind of, as long as I enjoy doing them and as long as there's an interest for them, I suppose I'll just keep doing them, or until I can't be asked.
That's why I'm kind of, well, this is going to be like, I'm ending, I've got like 5 more interviews left, and then that's me finishing this particular season and taking a wee break of it, because I was getting to the point where it wasn't folk going, oh, can I be on? It was more folk, oh, why have you got them on? Why have you got them on for this? I'm like, oh, at this point, just fuck off. That stopped my enjoyment of it. So I'm going to just do my, once I've got scheduled, and then just take a little break from it and then start up again in June. But
it's like, people are obviously like, I've absolutely no problem with trying to get yourself out there, like, definitely, but just like, try and read between the lines to a certain degree. Like in that Looking Sharp podcast, the seminar when he was talking about like finding work and stuff, like he was saying like make everything bespoke to each promotion thing. And I don't think that someone should like send me a CV to be on a podcast, but like look and see like if you're like, because they obviously acknowledged that they'd read these messages and then the only thing they took was that. And I was like, well, that's kind of annoying and somewhat toxic, but it's unsoured for me now, and I'm kind of enjoying them again. Plus, the TNA one I right enjoyed, man. I've watched that video with Dean Friesen, and I was just ripping the piss out of him so many times, man. It's amazing.
I just find it weird. I really enjoyed it. I think I would have enjoyed it more if I wasn't trying to figure out how to get my camera to work the whole time. And then I finally did, and I was like, yes! Oh, we're wrapping up. Shit. Okay.
Yes, Dean, why aren't you moving?
So the visual aid, the visual finish to this episode was going to be, because WrestleMania 37, which is obviously passed by the time this goes out, it brought back the amazing moving graphics, match graphics.
Oh, yes.
So I thought to end it, we were going to just like do a little bit of animation and then turn to the respective sides like we're doing a match graphic.
Right, okay.
I don't know how this is going to go.
I need props, because I'm... Right, I've got... Weirdly enough, right, I'm not even just saying that, like... This is not me just trying to pass off, like, oh, I'm quirky. But I just say that loud, I need props. I have a mug with an eye on it that's full of dry Cheerios. So that's my prop.
I will use my hammer, because I need an excuse to speak about this on any episode.
You don't need an excuse. Just if you want to have a wee minute and give a wee sales pitch, give a wee QVC. Like, we've got a really nice leather work on the handle, yeah. And for the next 10 minutes, fucking 99% off, guys.
My dog is scared of this because I was trying to flip it, like flip it like that, and I dropped it on her, and she will not go anywhere near it now because I keep doing that. I would go get it now.
Imagine doing like a dog training tutorial on YouTube where you just whip out Mjolnir to make her sit.
Run.
Speaking of quality, we were actually doing like an actual proper rounded off, like send off to the podcast, and then next thing you know, you're throwing Mjolnir about and I'm eating dry Cheerios from a mug.
Delicious, right. But... So this is how we're going to do it then. I don't know. I think I should do a countdown. Where we do the aggressive bits, and then we do the freeze frame, but we'll like point at each other. And then that's the bit I will screenshot and put out. That seems to be the best way to do it.
Right, okay.
I might add some lightning bolts if I know how to, but I don't, so might not. So, okay. Right, so just get the raw theme in your head. Money in this together. That one. Okay, right. So, aggressive. And then turn.
Am I looking the right way?
No. No, that makes it even better. Actually, it makes it even better. You're looking the wrong way. Right, that was that. Never do that again.
No,
it was an idea.
The best thing we've ever done. I love it. I've spat Cheerios all over my floor, and my girlfriend's gonna punch me in the neck.
I should have just went close up and just did the lean forward.
But like, this is a trophy.
Right,
my dad sent me that. Like, I told my dad something. I was like, "Oh, I got this cool thing delivered." And next thing you know, Dean in the chat, like, "Where are you at?"
It's the best picture ever.
Oh,
and
100%.
The fact that the story with it is that it was, it's the best thing ever. Anyway, we're good. You know what? Just because we're in the spirit of the socializing with Jason Reed, say it again. With Jason Hyde. What's your socials again? Well, then we'll do a fade out.
It's great. I can look at it with on my wee screen here. It's at Jason Hyde PW, which stands for Pro Wrestling or Pro Wrestler. I can't remember. Facebook's facebook.com/JasonHydePW. Oh, my Instagram. I kept getting told I look like Post Malone, so I made my Instagram Toast My Scone. So that's my Instagram, and I don't think I have anything else.
That's why I can never find you, because I keep looking for you when I'm trying to tag you and stuff. Obviously with you in it, and like I said, this is the fade out bit now, so thanks for being on. It's the 50th episode. So I keep trying to look for you. I might be right about Christmas you went Tinsel Boy,
and that's because my girlfriend, we both uploaded a photo of ourselves with tinsel draped over us, but I had just made mine into a scarf and she'd made hers into like a weird bra thing, so my Instagram was Tinsel Boy and hers was Tinsel Tits. Hers is still, actually it was Disco Tits. But then I put a ladle on it, and she changed it to ladle tits. And then it went to tinsel tits, and then now it's angel tits.
I'm so excited that this is the fade out.
Right, I'm just realised I put my girlfriend's socials out for the world. It's fine. She'll be happy for the followers, probably.
I'll be all right.